In his new series, the historian David Olasoka has hit upon a compelling way to trace the social and political landscape of Britain across a span of 180 years, focusing on just one building, a house through time. BBC Two explores the varied and changing inhabitants of a single dwelling in Liverpool, from its construction to the present day. There are some obvious parallels between this and the long-running series Who Do You Think You Are? Except that in this case the people whose histories are investigated are under no obligation to be related to the same celebrity, as long as they all had the same address. Every house in Britain has a story to tell, said Olasoka. This is undoubtedly true, although I'm not sure it means that every house has a story worth telling. I don't know how they settled on 62 Faulkner Street, but it was clear from the outset that a lack of incident wasn't going to be a problem. These days working mum Gaynor and her two children, Rosie and Tom, live there, in what seems a highly desirable area, but the terrace that holds number 62 has never stayed the same place for long. Once, of course, it was all fields, a country lane running alongside land belonging to a Mr. Faulkner. The street was developed piecemeal, which played havoc with the numbering. 62 used to be 58. The house was complete by 1841 and, priced at about £1,000, would have been intended for the city's wealthy new middle class. Its history, however, is not that straightforward. The first known inhabitant, Richard Glenton, was a lowly customs clerk who probably never earned more than £50 a year and took in lodgers to make ends meet. Next came the Orrs, a couple who began life in service and finished up rich, moving on to even bigger things. The central story belonged to Wilfred Steele, a wealthy cotton broker who was ruined by the Panic of 1857, the first global economic crisis, and who eventually ended up in debtor's prison. Although careful not to overindulge in speculation when the historical trail grows faint, Olasoka has a knack for conjuring characters out of old documents, and he was not about to shed a tear for a man whose lost fortune was founded on the slave trade. I really wish I could feel sorry for Wilfred Steele, he said, but I don't. Olasoka was probably right not to. Steele got out of prison, married, then abandoned his family to go off and start another one in the States, leading two stepdaughters to the workhouse. There was also a creepy painting of Steele in his younger days, atop a horse, recreating some Scottish legend, which let you judge the book by its cover. On the strength of this opener, there are three more to come. I am now I prepared to believe that every house has not just one, but many stories to tell. But I wouldn't pit my house against 62 Faulkner Street in any given decade. My name is Aaron Quinn. I'm 16 years old and I come from a place called Derry. This narrated introduction to Derry Girls, C4, is not all it seems. Aaron's weird cousin Orla was reading aloud from Aaron's purloined diary, much to Aaron's consternation. Set in 1990s Northern Ireland and loosely based on the teen years of writer Lisa McGee, being human, Derry Girls is such a fresh look at growing up with the Troubles as a constant backdrop that it sometimes unsettles, although it mostly stays on the charming side of wicked. Erin, Saoirse Monica Jackson, and her friends long to break free from the conformity of their convent school, but lack the resolve for even minor defiance. I'm not being individual on me own, says Claire. Rounding out the group is loudmouth loose cannon Michelle, who turns up to the first day of school with her English cousin James, the son of her Aunt Kathy. She went to England to get an abortion and never came back, said Michelle. Never had the abortion either. Such difficulties as the girls face spring as much from their desire to fit in as from their attempts at rebellion, and the Troubles are presented, so far, as an inconvenience. Soldiers boarding school buses, bombed bridges ruining plans, far less frightening than stone-faced headmistress Sister Michael. You couldn't call Derry Girls nostalgic. Exactly. It doesn't make me long to be the only English boy in a 90s Irish girls' school without any men's loos. But the period is recreated with care, and the script is affectionate, foul-mouthed and funny. I'm looking forward to next week.